On Hot Copy this morning, trouble at the country's premier state university. The selection of new deans of at least two colleges have caused a stir in the UP community. In the case of the College of Business Administration, the UP Board of Regents supposedly did away with the selection process and chose a nominee who allegedly had no previous academic experience. Commission on Higher Education Chairman Dr. Prospero De Vera III will be joining us today and will be answering all the issues hounding UP, these alleged irregularities, before it gets to become our very own version of the Ivy League U.S. scandal. All right. Thank you so much for coming to Headstart. Wow. Who would think this would happen to UP? All right. First, there are many columns that have come out, all right? I've read Dr. Michael Tan's column, Winnie Monsod's column, stories coming from different articles, sources messaging on what they call were irregularities in the selection process of UP deans. And let's start first with the most controversial one. Is the selection of Joel Tan Torres as the Dean of the College of Business Administration, known now as the Cesar Virata Building, no, in effect, okay, or the college. But essentially, for old UP students like me, it is the College of Business, all right? Joel Tan Torres was chosen by the Board of Regents as Dean, in which the issues are he's not qualified, he was not recommended by the selection committee, and he is a political appointee of some sort. Let's start with that, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. Let me start, Karen, by saying that in all public universities in the Philippines, all 111 state universities and colleges, the law requires that the power to appoint university officials resides exclusively in the Board of Regents.
Yes.
And in all public universities.
And that's 11 of you.
111 universities.
Yes.
All the boards select and appoint officials.
Yeah. What I'm saying is there are 11 members
of
the
11
board.
Members.
There's 11
so
of you.
What happens is that in public universities, a search committee is constituted to basically produce a report to help the Board of Regents make a decision. The role of the search committee is to look at the qualifications of the candidates, look at their vision for their college, conduct a public hearing, a public forum if necessary, put the good and the bad impressions on the candidates, and submit it to the Board of Regents in all public universities. I should know because I'm the chair of all public universities in the country. Okay, what makes UP unique is that in UP, the search committee is not allowed to rate or rank the candidates.
Is that right?
Yes, they're the only public university where the search committee is not allowed to score, it's not allowed to rate and rank.
So there's no such thing as a top three?
There is no ranking in a search committee report. There are no scores, there is nothing to rank. What the search committee does is put the good and bad points of the candidates, and then they submit this report to the chancellor, they submit this report to the president, they submit this report to the Board of Regents. So the Board of Regents uses the search committee report to decide. Some Board of Regents interview the candidates. In my case, I call the notable alumni of the college, I ask them what they think of the candidates, I talk to the students. Sometimes I interview the candidates.
And you can do that? That's allowed,
yes, that
honestly?
Yes, that can be done. That can be done. And then on the day that the choice is made, I balance all of this and make my decision as a member of the Board of Regents.
Are you allowed to talk to each other, you and other members of the Board of Regents?
Oh, yes, that happens.
So you can compare notes over
lunch?
Yes,
we can compare notes. We can look at the candidates. We can point out portions of the search committee report that are important. Now, this has been the rule in UP now. It was the rule 5 years ago. It was the rule 10 years ago. It was the rule 15 years ago. Okay, let me just read. This is two.
Let's answer point by point.
Okay.
Go on. All right, go ahead. You wanted to say.
Okay, so therefore, when Mike Tan and the University Council start saying, respect the search committee process, respect the choice of the search committee and the chancellor, what they're basically saying is substitute our choice to your choice.
Okay. Wait, for the viewers who may, there are many Mike Tans no, in the world.
Yeah. The Chancellor of UP Diliman.
Yes, we need to contextualize.
So when the Chancellor of UP Diliman
says... This is Mike Tan, is also a columnist at Philippine Daily Inquirer until today, and he's a professor.
Yes, when he says that, respect my recommendation, he's essentially turning the Board of Regents into a rubber stamp. What he's saying is, your decisions should be based on my recommendation. But he read the search committee report just like all the 11 Board of Regents.
And how many members are in the search committee?
It depends on the composition. It can be as few as five. Depends, can be seven.
Okay.
These are selected into a group. So,
but the controversial College of Business, how many are they?
I think there are five of them.
Okay.
I think there are five of them. So, you know, what search committee ranking are they talking about? What recommendations of the search committee are they talking about? The search committee is not allowed to rank or rate. Mm-mm. They're just putting their observations on the candidates. Mm-mm. And all the candidates are qualified.
Mm-mm. Now, the concerns were one is alleged interference in the search process. Would you say there was interference of any kind in the search process?
I don't know. I did not even attend the public forum of the candidates. I don't know what interference they're talking about. The Board of Regents or some members of the Board of Regents decided they wanted to interview the candidates of all deanships, not just Virata.
Okay.
Of all five colleges, they interviewed them several hours before the vote.
Because Dr. Tan brought that up as a concern, that he said interviewing nominees will be perceived as an additional process to an academic process. In other words, if you interview on the side, unlike, let's say, the JBC, the JBC is interviewing formally, right? So the JBC, the interview is televised. There's a panel of some sort, then you can see the interview. It's more transparent. But the UP interview, what's scary is you have candidates coming up to you saying, "Uy po, paano to? Paano yon? What do you mean?"
The interview they're talking about is an interview requested by Congressman Mark Go together with other regents in the boardroom of UP. It was a formal interview.
But why would a congressman, I mean, frankly?
Because he wanted to know more about the candidates. Because the search committee report probably did not give enough information that he needed.
But what is a congressman's business, frankly? I'm just
curious. He's a member of the board.
Okay.
He's a member
of
the board.
Good, you said that.
He's the chair of the House Committee on Higher Education. He and other sectoral regents interviewed the candidates.
But in the past, you've had politicians, frankly?
No. Automatically in all boards.
No, wanting to interview, I mean.
Oh, yes. Yes, this is done regularly in all state universities. Interviews are done.
With politicians there?
Because the House and the Senate Committee on Higher Education Chair automatically sit as a member of the board of all state universities.
But if I were to ask you, do you think that's a good idea?
Oh, yes. Anything that will help regents make decisions is a useful exercise.
But you would want academicians generally as members of the board, right?
No. Because all the boards automatically, the House and Senate Chair of Higher Education are automatic members of all boards.
Yeah, but my question is, why would Congressman Go, who apparently is a member of the board,
because he's a new member of the board,
why would he suddenly want an additional process? That's what I mean.
No, it's not an additional
of
process.
Of interviewing the candidates.
It's not an additional process. It is a request to know more about the candidates.
But was it done before? Because Dr. Mike Tan said
that was
interviewing will be perceived as an additional process.
But it is not prohibited.
Yeah, but then my question is, was that an additional process? In other words, in the last few years, has a sitting congressman, as a member of the board, ever asked that we interview a nominee?
In my socks. All the state universities, they interview the candidates.
But the congressman has requested
yes.
it?
Oh, yes.
Okay, fine.
In all the more than 111 state universities, interviews are conducted with the candidates.
The reason I'm asking this is the allegation is Joel Tan Torres is a political appointee.
Well, let's move first. That is a perception of Mike
Okay,
Tan.
Now, the plan to interview these candidates, which was perceived to be an additional process, has actually fanned all the intrigue that there are more political appointees in the making. You see, don't you see how it looks?
Okay.
Congressman Go asks for an interview, even if he's a member, and apparently a professor saying that was not part of the process.
Let me put it bluntly, Karen.
Okay.
Mike Tan accuses the Board of Regents of making political decisions and wants the Board of Regents to rely solely on the search committee report in making decisions. He forgets very conveniently that in 2014, when he ran for chancellor, the search committee report did not put his, resume in glowing terms. You read the search committee report. The top and outstanding candidate in that search committee report in 2014 was the incumbent chancellor, Cesar Saloma. Another candidate, Guy Claudio, who is now Dean of Social Work of UP, had glowing credentials in the search committee report. There were issues raised about Mike Tan, ethical issues.
Okay.
And yet the Board of Regents chose him to be chancellor in 2014.
So what you're saying is the Board of Regents then chose against the top recommendations.
Yes, if he says that the search committee report should be the sole basis, then he should not have been chosen candidate in 2014. In 2017, he ran again for a second term. It is the same Board of Regents that he is accusing now that gave him a second term, despite questions.
And you were there?
No, I was not
yet.
There. I was not there.
When did you come in?
I came in 2018.
Okay, so after Mike Tan's appointment.
Sir, it is the same Board of Regents that gave him a second term.
Yeah.
Now, if he says the Board of Regents is wrong in his case and should have chosen somebody else, then maybe I believe his argument that they should rely solely on the search committee report. If he accuses the Board of Regents of selecting political appointees, then he is a political appointee twice over. It is the same board that voted him for a second term, despite serious questions about his administrative performance.
So why do you think is this happening now?
Because his candidate lost. It is as basic as that.
So who was his candidate?
I don't know, but clearly not Joel Tan Torres and not Dan Sagil. Mm-hmm. Let me put another fact on the table.
No, you have to explain. Dan Sagil is the NCPAG
dean. Yeah, he's the dean of NCPAG. Okay. It's the dean, the new dean. The new dean of NCPAG. Is Dan Sagil, very competent academician. I find it funny that they say that Joel Tan Torres is not qualified.
Yeah. Let me read that, then you can know.
Yeah.
The issue with Joel Tan Torres, they say, is number one, he has no academic experience. Yeah. He doesn't have a PhD. He's an outsider, and he was not recommended, or maybe to make it right, not the top recommendee of the search committee. So the allegation is it's a clear violation of the integrity process. Okay, why Joel Tan Torres compared to, let's say, I've read it in, I think this was an Inquirer or Philippine Star article, a Philippine Star who wrote a Buchanko Cheap Politics at UP is one, and wrote that you have a Professor Lizares who clearly has a sterling track record academically. Go ahead.
The rules do not require the candidates for dean to be restricted solely to faculty members of the college.
Okay. That's
it is open to everyone.
Do you need to have a PhD to be a dean?
No.
It does not require a PhD. But then normally they have a PhD.
No, not necessarily. Some of the best deans in UP do not have PhDs.
Okay, like who?
So then including the Dean of College of Law now.
Really?
The Chancellor of UP Cebu.
So no PhD?
No PhD.
Okay.
In the College of Public Ad, Romy Ocampo was one of the most outstanding deans of the college. He did not have a PhD. The one who founded the National College of Public Administration and Governance did not have a PhD. They were brilliant academicians. They were brilliant academic leaders. You don't require a PhD. The president of UP does not have a PhD.
So, okay, we've set the record straight on that.
You know, because okay, if you insist on a PhD, it's like you're insulting Senator Angara, who became UP president. You're insulting S.P. Lopez, who became a president.
No PhDs.
No PhD. You're insulting Fred Pascual, who did not have a PhD, and who raised the budget of UP by 148% during his term. Outstanding UP president. No PhD. If you don't require it from the president and they turn out to be good presidents, why are you demanding it from deans?
Okay, now, with all due respect to Joel Tan Torres, who is not here with us, of course, not in the studio to defend himself, I am reading columns, articles that you can...
Joel Tan Torres?
Yes, you can talk about that.
Was the top notcher in the CPA board exams. He served in the Bureau of Internal Revenue, served in the PRC, outstanding alumni. The college awarded him outstanding alumni. They think he's good enough to be outstanding alumni, but not good enough to be their dean. That's hypocritical.
Now, it's all over that it says he was not. I think this is what you have to set the record straight. Let's stick to the facts. They say he was not on the short list of the search committee. Was he or was he not?
The rules do not allow for a short list.
Oh, really?
Okay,
the rules do not allow. So what is it? Is it a list? What? Okay, can we show this?
Okay, this is a 2005 Board of Regents decision. 2005, 15 years ago, it says. The search committee is a fact-finding committee whose job is to gather all information considered useful for decision-making.
But how do you even become a nominee? I'm curious, are you nominated by someone or the search committee kind of says, oh, let's say Karen can be a good dean and they put you in. How does it work?
You are nominated.
By someone?
By faculty members, by the alumni, by individuals.
Who nominated Joel Tan Torres?
I have no idea.
Okay,
not... It's probably the alumni of the college. Because he is... He is a practicing professional.
No, okay.
let me read, Khaled. The search committee shall not rank the nominees.
Can I see that?
That is 2005.
Can we show this?
Yes.
So that, okay, because there are so many columns written, you know, and let's stick to the facts first. So these are the search committee rules for the dean of UP.
As old as 15 years ago.
Okay, it says here, the search committee shall not rank the nominees. So walang top three.
There is no top three. There is no short list because they're not allowed to rank.
So the minute the search committee gives names, you're saying everyone is equal.
Everyone is treated equally and everyone looks at the search committee report and makes a decision.
Can the search committee say, even if someone nominated me, can they say, no, Karen is not qualified to be dean?
They cannot.
They can't?
If they are not qualified, they should have excluded them from the start. They should have excluded them from the start if they are not qualified.
So, in other words, what you're saying, the search committee shouldn't have even included the name.
Yes.
And said this person was nominated but not qualified.
Yes.
Can they do that?
They can, because it says here, Derek, there is a provision that says who are qualified.
Ah. So
who may be nominated.
So the minute you fall into this...
You're qualified.
Okay, but it seems so simple. It says willing to serve. I mean, shouldn't you all increase at least the qualifications?
But those are the rules.
The TOYM and the towns is even harder.
That is the rules.
Who needs to change this then? If they're going to say it's too easy to be nominated.
The Board of Regents should change it. The different constituents of the university should discuss it.
Because offhand, anybody, not anybody, that's not fair.
No, but remember, Karen, the same rules have produced brilliant deans and UP presidents.
So, okay. So you're saying, so you're saying
if you say
tightening the rules. For example, if you say must have master's and PhD is not the guarantee.
It is not. Because otherwise, if we say the rules are not correct, it's like insulting all the good deans, chancellors, and UP presidents who were selected using the same rules.
Thank you for watching. For more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.